All right, so welcome everyone, and thank you so much for joining our Teach Educational Rounds. Here with us today, we have Jodi Wolff and Carolynne Cooper, who will be presenting an overview of motivational interviewing and updates within health behavior change. So I'm going to begin with KMH's land acknowledgement. KMH is situated on lands that have been occupied by First Nations for millennia. Lands rich in civilizations with knowledge of medicine, architecture, technology, and extensive trade routes throughout the Americas. In 1860, the site of KMH appeared in the Colonial Records Office of the British Crown as the Council Grounds of the Mississaugas of the New Credit, as they were known at the time. Today, Toronto is covered by the Toronto Purchase Treaty No. 13 of 1805 with the Mississaugas of the Credit. Toronto is now home to a vast diversity of First Nations, Inuit, and Métis who enrich this city. KMH is committed to reconciliation. We will honor the land through programs and places that reflect and respect its heritage. We will embrace the healing traditions of the ancestors and weave them into our caring practices. We will create new relationships and partnerships with First Nations, Inuit, and Métis, and share the land and protect it for future generations. So I now invite everyone to introduce themselves in the chat and let us know which traditional territory you're joining us from today. If you're not sure, I can put this link in the chat. Give me one moment for you to find out. And you're also welcome to share something that you're doing to learn or improve your ongoing commitment to reconciliation. In the meantime, for those that are joining for the first time, I'll just give a bit more information about myself. So my name is Natalie, and like KMH, I'm currently located on the lands of the Mississaugas of the Credit. I'm of Italian descent. My grandparents arrived in Canada from Italy in 1958. I've lived in the city of Toronto for almost 2 years now, where I've grown to truly appreciate the community and the vibrancy this land has to offer. And I acknowledge the privilege I have as a white settler to live here and be within close proximity to all my daily needs. Especially as someone living with type 1 diabetes, I'm particularly grateful to have access to insulin and all my daily required medical supplies. So thank you for those sharing. Please do keep continue sharing and introducing yourselves in the chat. In the meantime, I'll just continue sharing some housekeeping items. So just an FYI that we have our Foundational Health Educator Workshop coming up in September. We're really pleased to be able to offer it again in person. So if you want more information about this, please do reach out to us via email at teach@kmh.ca. So if you're interested to receive a letter of completion for this Teach Educational Rounds, please make sure you've registered for the webinar and completed the pre-learning assessment. As well, make sure you signed into the webinar using your full first name and last name so we can track participation. And last but not least, please make sure to complete the evaluation and post-learning assessment that will be emailed to you by tomorrow. You'll also receive these slides and the recording along with that. So here's a little bit more information on our presenters today. First up, we have Jodi Wolff, who has over 19 years experience as a clinician, educator, and social work leader. She is currently a manager with Intrepid Labs here at KMH. Jodi has certification in concurrent disorders advanced competency, completed by DBT training, and is a member of MINT, the Motivational Interviewing Network of Trainers. And next up, we have Carolynne Cooper, who has over 25 years of experience working with individuals, groups, and family members. She has been a subject matter expert on a number of teaching and training initiatives, primarily focusing on MI and concurrent disorders, and also is also a member of MINT. So Carolynne is currently an advanced practice clinical leader at KMH. So welcome to both of you. And no disclosures to report on their end. So please note that the content of Teach Educational Rounds is centered on evidence-based guidelines from the following sources. Nonetheless, these materials, as well as the verbal presentation and any discussion, represent only general principles, and they do not remove the need for clinical assessments or treatment plans by healthcare professionals. So please feel welcome to use the chat feature throughout the webinar to post any comments or answer any questions from the presenters. To do this, you can click on the speech bubble icon in the control panel, and just ensure you select everyone so that all panelists hosts and attendees can read and respond to your comments. You're also very welcome to use the reaction feature throughout the webinar if you'd like to send a smiley face, thumbs up, or anything like that. But with that, I'll hand it off to our presenters. Thank you so much, everyone, and enjoy the webinar.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much. This is a true privilege to be here today, and we're very, very much looking forward to spending this time with you. So thank you so much in advance for that. Let's get started. I'm mindful of the time. We're going to squeeze in as much as we can. Just to mention that there's going to be a follow-up, a part two, where we'll go into a bit more depth in some of the areas, or one in particular. So today's really just intended to be an overview, and I'll just go through the learning objectives with you to identify the spirit and skills in motivational interviewing, recognize where elements of motivational interviewing are being used in your practice, which I'm confident that they are most for many or most of you, and to integrate motivational interviewing skills into continued learning, which is a really key principle of motivational interviewing, the continued learning piece, the practice. And we'll get into that as well. Let's keep moving just to look at what our overview is today. We're gonna do a definition of MI. We're gonna talk about MI spirit, and we're gonna talk about 5 MI micro skills, ORS and informing advising. So open-ended questions, affirmations, reflections, summaries, informing and advising. Ambitious given the time. So we'll keep moving along to get right into the definition. So in 2012, this is a definition that Miller and Rolnick put out, which is motivational interviewing is a collaborative conversation to strengthen a person's own motivation for and commitment to change. And this has been the definition that we've been using since 2012, really. But I want to highlight that this is founded in research. This is really supported by research. We know that MI can enhance treatment engagement, retention, patient goal setting, behavior change, enhanced motivation, durable treatment outcomes. We have a lot of evidence now supporting the use of motivational interviewing under the guise of this definition. About every 10 years or so, Miller and Rolnick review the definition and the text that guides us in our motivational interviewing practice and teaching, and put out a new iteration or a new edition of the text with any updates, any changes that they want to make reflecting our practice and teaching moving forward. That is expected to come in the summer, this coming summer is the next iteration. So we're really excited to be able to share with you an appetizer of the new definition of motivational interviewing. So the next slide shows the evolution, which is motivational interviewing is a way of talking to people about change and growth in order to strengthen their motivation and commitment. Carolynne, do you mind going to the next slide that will show that definition? There you go. So you can see that there's significant changes, and we're going to understand and learn more about this as the text is released, and we can start to flesh it out a bit more. But this is an appetizer, certainly, of what's to come. So I'll let you take a look at that.
Yeah, I really appreciate that, Jodi. You know, for me, motivational interviewing is organic, right? Like any organism, it grows, it changes, it responds to feedback within the environment and expands. So this is super exciting, and we'll learn more certainly as the book is published. We've heard a few teasers ourselves that we'll be happy to share with folks today.
Perfect. So let's shift to learning motivational interviewing and what that's like. We've talked a little bit about it already. Learning MI is an ongoing process. More than knowledge is evolved. When learning to fly an airplane, one may begin with hours of classroom instruction, but ultimately it's a matter of guided practice in the air. With practice and feedback, you can become more proficient. And the same is true with motivational interviewing. we could talk about it, learn it, memorize, you know, definitions until we're blue in the face, but it's truly in the practice, in the coaching, in you know, doing that we learn it, that we understand it. And I can say for Carolynne and I, who have been doing this for many, many years, we still practice and learn and teach and get to better understand, evolve as the definition and the theory itself evolves. So I think it's really important to keep this in mind, that it's not about one training, two trainings, a series of trainings. It's how am I going to continue to grow my understanding and practice of motivational interviewing. And really, we learn the most from our clients, from the people who say to us, hey, this works, this doesn't, or what does this mean, or why are you doing this? And really being receptive and open to that in an ongoing way allows us to become more proficient in our practice of motivational interviewing. An important detail that is different from some other theories that you kind of learn, practice, keep doing, but don't change necessarily. Motivational interviewing is unique in that it's really, the emphasis is really on the ongoing process of learning and evolving and understanding and improving.
So I'm going to ask Natalie to share a video, and it really invites you to consider how this might fit with motivational interviewing. Thank you, Natalie. Thank you very much, Natalie. So I saw a heart come up, and I'm really interested and curious to hear from you about how does this video relate to the spirit or our way of being in motivational interviewing? Any ideas or thoughts? Please go ahead and pop them in the chat. What did you notice about the relationship there between the boy and his dog? Beautiful. So we're seeing side by side support, pacing, kind of waiting. I'll be here while you explore. Seeing some of the evolution of MI, the guiding. Wow, it's really coming in fast now. The connectedness, the trust. Oh, wow. So we're hearing more about MI spirit, right? That emphasis on autonomy, noticing kind of the relationship between the boy and the dog. The dog was kind of sitting there being patient, as Kathy's pointing out, while the boy kind of explores that puddle, you know, just noticing that kind of kind, warm presence. Beautiful. And so, as you've pointed out, the heart of MI is the spirit of MI, which is our way of being when we're with people in the moment. And I love this image because it really highlights that moving, as folks mentioned, in partnership at the same pace, not racing ahead, not lagging behind, and as well as kind of that way of really taking time and acknowledging that people may need some time to think about a behavior change, for example. Noticing acceptance for who the person is at that moment in time. So the dog may or may not have seen this as unusual. You know, as a parent, I noticed no rubber boots on that little guy, right? But the dog was happy to, you know, let the exploration happen, and just to accept that little boy as he was in the moment, which is what we're always striving to do. We see compassion there, right? Compassion for the exploration, but in terms of the work we do with clients, that compassion in terms of acting in the best interest and collaborating. You know, was it the best interest for the little boy to have soaking wet socks? I don't know. But there was that patience and trust, and emphasis on autonomy, right? One of the new pieces that we wanted to share with you is empowerment. So in the past, the spirit of MI included evocation, and Miller and Rolnick kind of done some thinking about that and have kept that for sure in the four processes. But thought really, you know, empowerment is that moment where we come together and combine the best advice that we bring as healthcare professionals with that wisdom of the client in terms of this kind of state of heart and mind, so that we're not using our skills on a client. You know, sometimes I hear people saying, oh, just MI them, right? To get them to change. So I think that's a new piece. In the chat, maybe what we can do is just invite folks to share a couple of the things that may pull you away from being in MI spirit with your clients. I know it's always a bit of a tug of war, right? So what are some of the things that take you away from this way of being when you're working with folks? And I think that we're not judging these. These are real challenges. I'm just going to give folks a moment to think about that. One of the things that I can share, just reflecting on the work I've done in the past, is, you know, having to do a full assessment, get the whole picture of our clients' goals, everything that's going on in their lives, their values, their level of substance use, their level of nicotine use, any legal issues, all those kinds of pieces in an hour and a half. So not only am I engaging and trying to build a relationship, I'm trying to gather a huge amount of information and stay in my spirit. That's one of the challenges that I know I've experienced. And we'll just leave it for folks to think about it and to pop any challenges that come to mind as we continue in the chat. So I'm sharing this quote from someone that I have learned a lot from. His name is Steve Malcolmberg Smith, and he's one of my mint colleagues. And he reflected once, you know, people will not attempt to change until they feel understood. Until there's that sense of, oh, I get what's important to you and what the real challenges are. And I'm in a place where I can accept you. So I think that this speaks to MI spirit. And I'll invite you to add any comments as we move through this. I'll look forward to seeing them. Oh, I'm seeing the comments now. Sorry, I didn't realize I needed to slide that chat down. So now lots of people are sharing and have shared. Thank you very much. And my apologies for being a bit slow there. The idea of appointment times can get in the way, as I mentioned, Sometimes the writing reflex can get in the way, and we'll be happy to talk lots more about that. Different perspectives, right? Programming constraints, not being in the same place, right? Or moving at the same pace because of sometimes the mandate of the agency, large caseloads. Those are things that can pull us away from being in MI spirit. And discord, so really appreciate that. That there are times where we just need to slow down, and we'll come to this immediately, repair that relationship. So really appreciate that comment, Christine.
Carolynne, can I just bring us back to the video for 1 second? There was a moment in the video where the dog almost seemed like he didn't really understand what this little boy was doing. He kind of looked back and hesitated, like, what is going on? And had the ability to say, okay, I'm gonna radically accept it. This is where you're at. I'll wait for you. I'll wait, and we can do this together. So it just speaks to some of those comments as well, that we have this constraint and we don't always start on the same page. So how to bring ourselves back there is really important.
Perfect. Thank you, Jodi. So one of the things that MI has capped and will continue in this 4th edition are these 4 key tasks. In the 3rd edition, we talked about 4 processes. Now I was really thinking about there's key tasks or things that we do. And the groups already kind of acknowledge this when they think they've talked about the relational foundation, engaging, connecting with the other person at a human level as well as at a helper level, right? Acknowledging, you know, what their needs are, who they are as individuals, and then kind of coming together and looking at, so what are we going to do with the time that we have here? We may have 6 things that we've talked about, and, you know, of discussing housing, relationships with family members, nicotine use, other health concerns, you know, what 1 or 2 things are the most important for us to spend the next kind of 40 minutes on together? So we've got that focusing piece. Evoking is one of the things that really is important in terms of motivational interviewing, where we're evoking thoughts, experiences, maybe past experiences of change and challenges that have come up. Also thoughts and feelings about, hey, you know what? I'm having these health issues, and, you know, smoking is really the only thing that gives me joy at this point in time. And really taking some time and evoking what that experience might be like to even just consider making a change or looking at things in a little bit different way. So we have engaging, focusing, evoking, and planning. And through these, empowering exists across, up and down those stairs. And as a couple people pointed out, you know, there may be times when we're in the evoking process and we need to go back and do some engaging or re-engaging or refocusing too. So these aren't linear. We're not always moving up the stairs. It's sort of like Tom Hanks in Big, right? We're dancing back and forth amongst the processes. So all of this happening in MI spirit. So we're gonna move on and talk about each of the micro skills. And I'm gonna share a Slido question. So just tell me, Natalie, when you're ready for me to share my screen. So I'm gonna invite folks to have their cell phones handy, because we have a QR code that we'll use.
Then you should be able to share it. Is it not letting you?
I'm just gonna try. So sometimes what it makes me do is it makes me run through the presentation again. So I apologize for that, but here we go.
There we go.
So our question really invites you to think about what are the qualities of a good question? When you think about good open question in your context, and we should get instant response. So everybody will be able to see, and Jodi and I will certainly share your feedback as it comes in. So please, you can join either by scanning the QR code or by going to slido.com and then putting in the number. Okay, so so we have curious. We're getting some examples, thought-provoking, beautiful, something that makes us reflect. So things that might ask you to think about what the reasons are for something. Invitations, value-based. Oh, they're coming in so fast. Help me out, Jodi. Non-judgmental. Okay, so coming from a place of openness.
I love simple, that it doesn't have to be really complex.
Yes.
Non-accusatory, lovely, and supportive.
Supportive. Ask questions to understand that are reflective and empathic in nature. Beautiful. And that are open. Also things like help me understand and tell me about. Beautiful examples of open questions there. Okay, yeah, and we want to keep them clear and concise. That's particularly important when we're looking at folks who experience co-occurring mental health concerns, right? We don't want them to be so complex that people can't even absorb and consider how to respond. So something that allows for a story to unfold. And we want to attend to our body language. Okay, lots of great examples.
Tell me more about is a great prompt, a great way to start.
Yeah.
Having eye contact, the idea of body language, the power of body language and the role that it can play in MI is huge. It's a great point. It's so hard to stop this because you can see all the participants typing at the top.
You can see people really thinking all that work is getting, you know, thoughts about pacing, right? That it's a relaxed, that we're not rushed. And we'll certainly come to that in a minute too as we talk about reflections. Exploring all those kind of aspects of people's experience, from their feelings to their thoughts to understanding more about the big picture. So I am going to stop just because we are keeping an eye on the time and we want to move on to the rest of our micro skills. So thank you very much, everyone. So I just stopped my audio because we are at a hospital, so there's always announcements overhead. And maybe what we can do is just move on to the, I'll just move us on to the next slide. So open-ended questions, as people have pointed out, they begin a conversation. And I think there's not a lot to add there, right? We want to typically keep it open and really think carefully about how we frame things to a number of your points, right? That they're not accusatory, that we're showing curiosity and interest. They may be specific, like what's worrying you most about your health? When you say your family, who's in your family? And we may want to avoid those why questions early on, just because they can have an impact on forming that relationship. So we're gonna move on and look at our next micro skill. And so again, we have a video that we're looking for folks to watch. And as you do, we're going to invite you to use the chat, and I'll prop in, we're going to ask you to notice like what fits with what you know or have heard about MI and what doesn't.
I'm here to get validated.
You are awesome.
Excuse me?
You have an amazing face. You've got powerful features, man. Anyone ever tell you that?
No.
And listen, you look a little down. And it may seem like sometimes people don't understand you. But someday, man, someday, people are gonna see you for what you really are.
You really think so?
Absolutely. You are great.
Need a validation, please?
You are great, ma'am. You have amazing cheekbones.
Really?
Sir, yes. We have a situation.
Where?
Oh my gosh.
Thanks for sharing that, Natalie. This video always brings a smile to my face, and I hope it did for others as well. Please, in the chat, share any reactions that you had, anything that stood up, uplifting, customer, complimentary comments. I'm curious also in the chat if you can share, was this, you know, align, does this align with MI? Was this reflective of motivational interviewing practice? And what wasn't or what was? I think it was, it certainly is. Sorry, Carolyn.
Sorry, I see we have a comment and a question there already about, was this affirmation, validation, or praise? So yeah, keep it coming.
That's such a good question. Thank you for that, Gamnet. You versus I think. So that's another really important, this is so great, such great points. You know, we want to be really careful with motivational interviewing, with our practice, that we're not cheerleading. We're not just here to say, yeah, you go, you got this. It doesn't come off as genuine. When you think about actual cheerleaders, you know, it's designed to be exaggerated. It's designed to be really dramatic. And that's not what we're looking to do. We also don't want it to be, I think you're, we don't want it to be about us. We really want the focus to be on the individual and what they're bringing to the table, as opposed to us giving them a grade or evaluating how they're doing on something, because that's not what it's intended to be. I'm just looking here, comments on physical attributes, looks, yes. Would not necessarily be a, can you imagine if anyone came in, today your outfit looks great. Tomorrow I'm not so sure. It's such a good point. Not evaluating is really important. Affirmations typically result in positive change. That's a really good point. We want to nurture a worldview of competence and not deficit. So we do, we want to focus on the positives. We really want to really highlight those things. But as is being said, you know, affirmations function as strength building and reinforcing. I like confidence building feedback, but not physical features. I'm glad you're here today. Exactly. And even if we were to shift, I'm glad you're here today. It's great that you're here today, or you worked really hard to get here today. So it's about what they did as opposed to how I feel about it. So even small tweaks like that, just to really shift the focus. Overhyped tone, help people see the positives in themselves. You know, it can feel like such a small thing, but often seeing the positives in ourselves is something we overlook so quickly. the first person seemed to change when they felt understood. And I think that's really important too. I mean, it's affirmations are not something that we hear often necessarily. It's not always a part of our daily conversation. So to make that concerted effort to highlight those things can be really, really valuable and can make that quick of an impact. So I really like that. Carolynne, do you wanna go to the next slide? We have a few key points about affirmations that we can highlight together as well. The use of honesty, and that's really important because our clients see right through us. They know when we're being genuine, they know when we're being honest. I really like that point, highlighting again, the self-efficacy is so important, the morale with past actions, backing up an affirmation with past actions, so lovely. Avoiding the generic cheerleading type statements, again, the clients see right through us, right? We wanna make sure that it's things that are really true to what they're bringing to the session. So instead of "you're smart," it's smart that you're thinking of your options. So highlighting the behavior, highlighting what it is that they're doing that demonstrates this quality, avoiding the use of the I statement. So as I said earlier, trying to make it, to ensure that it's not about us. The affirmation is really about the individual and something that they bring. Try affirming strengths and values when the client is less ready to change. And that's really important too, because oftentimes that's who we're seeing is the clients who they're ambivalent. They're not sure that this is something they really want to do, but helping to affirm the strengths, the values, what they are doing can really help foster change talk, can really help foster the momentum toward change, which is what we're trying to do. Excellent. So let's move on to another piece of our oars, to reflective statements. Carolynne, I'll pass it over to you.
Thanks, Jodi. So reflections continue to evolve the conversation, and they're fundamental to motivational interviewing. But what we're really doing with reflections is we're showing our empathic understanding. So we're working to co-create meaning together. We're ensuring that when I say, "Wow, I'm really feeling good today," as a practitioner, Jodi understands what that means. So Jodi may come with a number of hypotheses, and that's maybe context dependent too, right? But we're using a statement, not a question. So we want to make sure our voices stay solid, you know, like they're flat, they're not going a little bit up at the end like this. You know, as we do in English when we ask questions. But really they're increasing that opportunity of building that relational foundation, of ensuring that we're engaging our client. Lots of times when I'm coaching, I really invite folks to start out by thinking about how they could turn a question, because we're curious. Talking professionals, we're socialized into like being curious and finding and thinking that we get information primarily through asking questions. So lots of times when I'm coaching, I invite folks to think about what might be an evocative reflection. Yeah, so thank you. I'm seeing in the chat that, you know, using reflections really helps a client feel truly heard and understood. And we're making reflections that are not diverting attention or trying to fix. We're strategically choosing a part of the statement that could be more deeply explored. And I'm going to show an image that I just love to work with. So simple reflection often stays pretty close to what the individual said. It's good early on to build that connection, to start to engage the person. Problem is, if we only use simple reflections, we wind up stuck in a reflective loop, which is like, After a while, it's like, yeah, we just talked about that. Yeah, I just said that. Yeah, and if we're working with a population that's potentially a transition age youth, they may say, yeah, I just told you that. Like, aren't you listening to me? So with a complex reflection, what we ideally want to do is go a little bit under the surface. So reflect something that someone has said and gone a little bit beyond what they have said to include what they meant. But we don't want to be going so deep with a reflection that people are feeling exposed and incredibly vulnerable. So, as you've pointed out already, we can reflect feelings. We can link those feelings with events and the experience and maybe even the existential. We can reflect what it meant to you to receive this diagnosis and what has got you considering right now. And this is our way of conveying accurate empathy, as I mentioned. And really inviting folks at one point, we want to step out from kind of behind this reflective mirror that we're holding up that invites people to sit back and really engage and consider things. And then continue that discussion. So I'm hoping that not everybody is hearing the dog in my background. It's a little bit distracting for me. We've got therapy dog on the unit. So simple reflections, complex reflections. I also think in the context of concurrent disorders, and this is one thing I coach folks on regularly, how important it is to let that reflection kind of come and land on the person and give them a moment or two to process it. And not divert their attention by saying, did I get that right? What do you think about that? Jodi, it looks like you're ready. You just want to jump in and you've got something that you're thinking about saying.
No, this is perfect. I love this analogy and just reiterating the idea that going too deep, exposing something too personal is in itself risky, but no, nothing, it's great.
So I'm wondering, do other folks have comments about reflections? Because certainly learning reflective listening can be a real challenge. And it's one of those things where, you know, practice can be incredibly helpful, as can coaching and feedback. And I think about my own experience learning MI. I gotta say, it's cringe inducing to hear my voice recorded, to see me, you know, in a sim or with, you know, permission with a friend or a colleague practicing. And at the same time, you know, we've all got that 2020 hindsight, right? That goes, oh, you know what? Taking a pause there would have been, you know, more effective. Our reflection could have gone much further had you tweaked it and just made it a little bit shorter. So I just wonder about people's experience in learning reflections and in using reflections. We've heard from a couple people. So avoiding those evaluative reflections, making sure that people are feeling really heard, understood. So I'm just going to move us on to our next micro skill. And if people comment in the chat, you're welcome to do that.
Summaries. So summaries, we include the picture of the flowers because Miller shared this metaphor. MI is filled with metaphors and analogies, and this is one of them, the collection, a bouquet of flowers that you present back to the clients. And the idea is that each flower reflects an idea or something that the client brought forward. So gathering together a select number of key points in the conversations, the flowers, in order to connect the dots and present the bouquet. And Miller's example is, before I ask you the questions, I mentioned earlier, let me summarize what you've told me so far and see if I've missed anything important. You came in because you were feeling really sick and it scared you. One of the things that I think is particularly important about summaries is that people often think that summaries are intended to be used as a point of pivot, as a point of ending. Ending one conversation to move on to the next, ending a session perhaps. And I just want to highlight that's one function of summaries. Another function of summaries is to ensure that what you're gathering or what you're hearing is correct the way you would in a reflection. Giving it back to the client, have I missed anything? Do I have this right? Presenting the you know, key points, the headings of a newspaper, if you will, to show the client that you have truly understood and not necessarily waiting to the end to do that. Because the risk of waiting to the end, one of the risks is that you've missed something the whole time. And or perhaps that you thought something was a smaller flower or a weed, when in fact it was intended to be the sunflower. It's the main reason why they're there. It's the biggest piece of their bouquet. So being really, really careful about how we use summaries and intentional in how we use summaries. I'm wondering if there's any, please use the chat if there's any thoughts you have about summaries, ways that you might use summaries in your conversations with clients. Yeah, it certainly can be. You know, as Carolynne said, one of the things that I think about when I'm earlier in my session, I typically focus more on reflections early on. It's my way of validating, it's my way of affirming, kind of staying more into the reflections, but certainly giving providing a summary to say, here's what I'm hearing you say, there's a lot going on. You have this and this and this and this. Is that right? Is that everything? You know, am I hearing you right? Have I missed anything really important? It certainly can be a way to make sure that you're on the same page as you move forward. If there's anything they'd like me to add, is such a lovely way to use summaries as well. Solidify things I've discovered, especially as someone with ADHD, memory. I so appreciate that point. And, you know, often, even without all the diagnosis, the anxiety of being in a session. And feeling like you've got this set time to share everything that you can, or not wanting to share very much at all. Using summaries to open that up, to be able to take the conversation further, is so valuable. Thank you for sharing that. Summaries can help to say, okay, this is what I'm hearing so far. What is the top priority for you? Have I missed anything? Absolutely, it can certainly shift where the conversation is going. And sometimes it's helpful for the client to see, oh, wow, there is a lot. And it can feel very validating. Thank you so much for all of that. And yeah, there's so much more. Let's move on to the fifth micro skill.
Yeah. So informing and advising is our fifth micro skill. We often call it elicit, provide, elicit, or check, chunk, check. And really, this is an opportunity for us to engage in a bit of an environmental scan. So what do you already know about the impact of nicotine, tobacco use, smoking weed on your health? And then we take that opportunity to validate anything that the client says that fits. And say, hey, you know, how would it be if I shared a little bit more information? And this is the chunking, right? This is not an information download where we're telling you all the latest research and all the details about how to, you know, like the benefits, our risks of not making a change, the benefits of making a change. This is where we chunk out one thing. Oh, you've heard that for some folks, taking medication can be really helpful. What else have you heard about that? Okay, that's great. So it can be helpful. You've heard that you need to take the medication at the same time every day. I'll tell you a few more details if that fits for you. And then you share a couple of details and then you might check back in. So with informing and advising, and I think this is where in many ways, as healthcare professionals, we can bring that expertise, but we need to do it in a very paced and thoughtful way. So, key elements. Yes, this is the same as ask, provide, ask. We've got lots of different names. It's essentially sharing information, informing and advising in an MI style. So, keeping in mind that once we've got permission, which can include us asking, or can be, you know, I've come today and I really need to know, what can I do to ease my breathing? You know, it's really frustrating. I'm trying to run around with grandchildren and I don't have the breath to do it. So that's considered clients asked you for the information. We want to take our time so that progress can be quicker. You know, we have a great colleague, Wayne Skinner, who said, you know, if you act like you've got all day, it may only take 15 minutes. But if you act like you've only got 15 minutes, it could take all day. So I love that. We're presenting information in a real matter-of-fact style, using plain language, plain talk. We might share others' experiences, you know, so we might say, well, and I've done this myself in the past, lots of other people who've attended group treatment have found X, Y, and Z. And we always want to check in with our clients and say, what do you think about that? Or how could this fit with you? Some kind of key question.
Okay, I'm mindful of the time, but we'll do a quick review of change talk. The idea of change talk is ultimately what we're looking for in motivational interviewing. We're looking from our clients, is there a desire, an ability, reason, or need to make a change? Is there any language suggesting a commitment, an activation, a readiness, taking steps already? We're looking for people to recognize that there's a problem, there's an ambivalence, there's something that's not going the way that they want, or something that they're looking to change. There might be through articulation of concerns, it might be through expressing their frustrations about side effects or something that they're experiencing. They may express an intention to change, not necessarily knowing what that might look like or how to get there, but showing an optimism about the possibility that a change can exist. That's what we want, just that seed, just to know that there's the potential that something could look different. And that's what we want to fuel. That's what we want to help grow, is that seed of possibility that change could exist. Okay. Menu of options.
So we thought we'd include a couple of tools, and I think that that can be really helpful. So I like this image. I took it when I was traveling over Northern Ontario, way, way up north. I think somebody is joining from that territory because I saw Fort Francis, I think, in the chat. So this could be a visual, or we could use circles. And this is really, you know, an analogy, so many lakes to explore, so many choices. So I would encourage folks to say, hey, you know, we've talked, like as a clinician, I might say, hey, we've talked about these things, and I'd name them specifically and say, of all these different options, which one or two might we take our time to focus on today? Motivational interviewing uses a range of structured tasks, and often scaling questions can be really helpful for determining where folks are at, as well as for pulling for change talk. Now, I have done some work up north, and so I don't tend to use a ruler. I would use an image. You know, how full is your glass? Or if you're thinking about the image of a tree, like where would you say you are in terms of potentially readiness to change, or in terms of confidence about changing? So I might have someone say, you know, I'm about half, my glass is about half full. I might say, wow, so you're feeling like there might be ready to take a step. But help me understand what's got you at half full rather than, say, a quarter full. Because that pulls for change talk. And so I think we have one Slido left that I can share. I'm just going to try and do that very briefly.
So we'll just invite you to reflect on today's session and think about how will this impact your practice moving forward. We can certainly tell from the chat that many of you, as we suspected, are already practicing motivational interviewing. So how might today's session impact your practice? I think Carolynne's just going to send it to you again, although I'm mindful of the time. Perhaps we can use the chat and invite people just to populate.
Sorry, now I've got the Slido up. So I'm just trying to. Yeah, if we're using the chat, that's fine.
Yeah, let's just use the chat and think about how this will impact your practice.
So remembering to pause more. Feeling more confident in using MI.
And we are going to share some books.
Yeah, we have some resources.
Amanda, yeah, we have some resources to share.
So focusing is one takeaway. Practicing reflections. Lovely. Allowing the client to lead. The glass as an option. Yeah, I just keep in mind that the glass was something I learned coming into First Nations communities. The different images can be really helpful. And loving empowerment versus evocation. And so not using MI as a tool on folks, but a way of being with folks. So as you pop your experiences in the chat and your takeaways, we do want to share resources. So I'm going to highlight a couple of the newest resources. So Motivational Interviewing in Healthcare, second edition, just came out earlier this year. It's a small paperback, really designed for those of us who work in healthcare. Beautiful, practical examples. So that's one. I think these are all great books. The other thing I would love to highlight, because it's quite new, is Motivational Interviewing for Mental Health Clinicians, a toolkit for skills enhancement. Like the Rosengren book, which was published a few years before, this is a workbook and it offers opportunities to engage in discussion with colleagues to use in your own community of practice if you have that. So I'd highlight those, and there's of course tons more, but those are some of the highlights. And of course, we're looking forward to MI4 in the fall.
We'll pass it back to you then, Natalie. Thank you so much, everyone, for your participation today.
Thank you both so much. That was an amazing presentation, and we had so much great engagement and discussion with all the attendees today. So thank you so much, everyone. I do recognize the time. So if you do need to head out, feel free to do so. I just have a couple of kind of concluding slides and reminders before we head out. So just a reminder that the webinar is being recorded and I will be distributing the link to anyone that registered, as well as a copy of the slides by tomorrow. And you're welcome to share this with any colleagues if you'd like. You'll also get the post-learning assessment and evaluation with that. That will be needed to be completed by next Wednesday if you're interested in receiving a letter of completion. And like Jodi mentioned at the beginning, we are going to be doing a part two of this with Jodi and Carolynne next month. So you're all welcome to join us on July 12th. Registration will be opening soon, so stay tuned for that. And as always, we have an archive list that lives on our website. So if you'd be interested in viewing another webinar or viewing this one again, you're welcome to check that out on our website. But last but not least, thank you so much all again for your participation today. And thank you again, Carolynne and Jodi, for such a great presentation today. Thanks, everyone. Bye.